Hello everyone, myself Dr. Madhuri. I'm taking respiratory system examination in today's class. So what is the importance of doing respiratory system examination? So this to be done after taking history from the patient. When patient comes to us, if he gives history of fever, cough, cold, difficulty in breathing, throat pain, hemoptysis, all such symptoms, it leads to us think about that maybe the respiratory system would have involved. And to further diagnose a patient based on symptoms, we do a clinical examination of a particular system. Okay. So let's see in the next slides. Respiratory system consists of upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract. Upper respiratory tract, nose, tonsils and pharynx. When the patient is having upper respiratory tract infection, URTI, so maybe the patient is having complaint of fever, cough, cold, a throat pain, all such things the patient might be having. Okay, and when we examine the upper respiratory tract, we get to know that the patient is having URTI. Okay, in lower respiratory tract, it is trachea, bronchi, lungs and pleura. So when such a lower respiratory tract infection has been involved, even the other symptoms also patient might be having. He might be having difficulty in breathing also. Okay. So let's see in the next slide. So when we have to examine respiratory system, there are certain steps for this systemic examination. We have to do inspection, then palpation, then percussion, and then auscultation. On inspection, we don't have to touch the patient, but we have to just observe. Okay. And on palpation, inspectory finding which we have got, we confirm by doing palpation. Okay. Then we go for percussion and then we go for auscultation. Now in this picture, I just want to show you what is midclavicular line. What is anterior axillary line? What is capillary line? Okay, so we will see one by one. Now, you can see this is a clavicle. This is a sternum and this is also a clavicle. So, the line which is passing in the middle of the clavicle is midclavicular line. Then, line which is passing from the anterior axillary fold, you can see in this picture. So that is anterior axillary line, and from posterior axillary fold is posterior axillary line, and from the midpoint of the axilla, so that is mid axillary line. Then from the scapula, the line which is vertical line passing is scapular line, and in the vertebral column, the line which is passing is vertebral line. So scapular line is almost parallel to the vertebral line. So midclavicular line, mid axillary line, scapular line. Okay, these are also important when we will do percussion. Okay, now what is sternal angle? Okay, so it is nothing but a transverse bony ridge at the junction of the sternum and the manubrium. Okay, and it is also known as a angle of Lewis or Ludwig's angle. So let's see in the picture. You can see what I say, transverse bony ridge at the junction of the sternum and manubrium. So this is manubrium, this is body of sternum. So at the junction of this body of sternum and manubrium, this. So this is sternal angle or Ludwig's angle or angle of Lewis. What is the importance of this? Why do we have to know about sternal angle? So significance is, from this sternal angle, the second costal cartilage articulates to the sternum. And so, below this second rib, we have second intercostal space. Okay, so this is second rib, and below this we have second intercostal space. So, while doing percussion, auscultation, when we want to do on second intercostal space, so we can easily identify the second intercostal space, because on the sternum from here we come down, and from where we feel ridge like, so there is a second intercostal second rib, and below that there is second intercostal space. The trachea also bifurcates into the bronchi, two bronchi at this point, that is sternal angle at that point. The upper border of atria of the heart also coincides at this point, and the disc between T4 and T5, that is thoracic vertebrae, okay, in the back also coincides to this point. So that is why this is important. Now let's see inspection. On inspection, we have to check for position of trachea, shape of chest, movement of chest, respiratory movements, apex beat, color of skin, prominent veins over the chest wall, or any previous injury or suture marks seen on chest or not. So these are the 8 points we have to see. Let's see one by one. Position of trachea. Normally, the trachea is situated centrally or slightly on the right side. Okay, but when it has not been situated in this normal position, so how do we come to know on inspection? That is what we have to learn. So when the trachea is not in central or not slightly on right side, rather it has been shifted more towards the right side or more towards on the left side. So what happens is, whichever side the trachea has been shifted, that side of the sternocleidomastoid muscle will become prominent. So that is known as trail sign. So in this picture, see there, this left side of the sternocleidomastoid muscle has become prominent because the trachea has been shifted to the left side. So trail sign is positive. Here the trail sign is present. Okay, so this is importance of position of trachea on inspection. So whichever side sternocleidomastoid is prominent, that side the trachea has been shifted. Okay, next, shape of chest. So normally the chest is bilaterally symmetrical. On cross section, it is elliptical in shape. So transverse diameter and AP diameter ratio is 7:5 normally, and that is known as Hutchison's index. Okay, so in this picture you can see this is AP diameter, anterior posterior. The diameter is measured between anterior aspect of the chest and posterior aspect of the chest, and this is a transverse diameter of the chest. So normally the transverse is more than AP, and then the shape becomes on cross section elliptical, and bilaterally chest is symmetrical. That is what we can say. But when the chest is not symmetrical, okay, when there is change in the shape, what are those clinical conditions we get to see? So flat chest. Okay, in flat chest what happens is, the supraclavicular and infraclavicular fossa gets exaggerated. See, in this picture you can see, this is this shape of chest normally. Normally this should be the shape of chest, but here in flat chest this becomes like this. The shape becomes like this. See, this is flat chest. Okay, normally it is thin, sometimes in healthy person also, on in abnormal conditions like in case of bilateral tuberculosis, in rickets, in children, okay, you get to see the flat chest. The next condition is pectus excavatum. So what is pectus excavatum? That is, this sternum will be protruded outward, and this is pigeon shaped chest. So this is how you see the chest. Okay, so sternum is protruded outward beyond the plane of the anterior abdomen. Okay, which is, this pectus excavatum is seen in rickets, and also when the children are having recurrent lung infection, in those children the chest shape will be pectus excavatum, pigeon shaped chest. The next is pectus carinatum. So there it is opposite to excavatum. Here there is lower part of the sternum will be depressed. You can see here lower part of the sternum is depressed, and so the chest is like this. There is depression. Okay, you can see here whether normal is this dotted line. Okay, this is seen in case of rickets also, congenital rickets. Okay, now Harrison's sulcus. Okay, here you get to see in this picture, this is Harrison's sulcus. Okay, it is also seen in rickets. Okay, it is nothing but the groove is seen here. You can see the transverse groove, okay, in the chest. Then scoliosis. Scoliosis is nothing but the lateral bending of the spine. Okay, and kyphosis is nothing but the backward bending of the spine. So here you can see backward bending also, and kyphoscoliosis is together, the kyphosis and scoliosis. Okay, so kyphoscoliosis is this is a picture. Normally the chest is this, but in kyphoscoliosis it becomes, the shape becomes like this. Okay, so this scoliosis is actually what happens in scoliosis is the spine becomes laterally bended. Okay, and rotation of the vertebra. Okay, so what happens is the prominence of the chest takes place. Okay, and scapula. Okay, now in kyphosis is a in case of osteoarthritis, in case of ankylosing spondylosis, okay, osteoporosis, the kyphosis is seen. Now barrel shaped chest. So barrel shaped chest is the one where the transverse diameter is not more. Normally transverse S to AP is more, but here the AP diameter increases. Okay, and it almost becomes 1:1. Okay, so this is a picture. How you get to see? See this normal one. Okay, you can easily see the transverse is more, but here in barrel shaped chest, see the AP has become more, and it becomes 1:1. It is seen in COPD, emphysema, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, that is emphysema. Okay, now movement of the chest. So on inspection, we have to just observe the movement of the chest, that on both the side of the chest is moving equally. It is not like one side of the chest is moving and another one is moving less or not moving. You have to just observe that is not happening. Okay, so let's see that. See here, both the side of chest is moving equally, closely, you can see. Now, respiratory movement. So respiratory movement, under that we have to see for respiratory rate. So normal respiratory rate is 12 to 18 per minute. Okay, so how do we count respiratory rate? That is, you have to see the movement of the thorax. Okay, so when the patient breathes in and out, inspiration and expiration, there you have to count respiratory rate as 1. Then again, when inspiration, expiration, you have to count respiratory rate 2. This is on inspection, just observation. Okay, just movement of the thorax we have to see. Okay, normal is 12 to 18 per minute. Rhythm, okay, we have to see whether it is regular or irregular. Then we have to check for depth. Okay, whether the depth of the respiratory movement you have to observe. If the respiratory rate is more than 18, it is known as tachypnea, and when the respiratory rate is less than 12, then it is bradypnea. Okay, then type of respiration. So respiration are of two type. One is abdominothoracic and another one is thoracoabdominal. Now abdominothoracic means the abdominal movement is more prominent as compared to thoracic movement, and thoracoabdominal is the thoracic movement is more prominent as compared to abdominal. So this abdominothoracic type of respiration is seen in males, whereas the thoracoabdominal type of respiration is seen in female. So what are the causes of tachypnea and bradypnea? Okay, that we will see in the next slide. So tachypnea causes are again divided as a physiological and pathological. Physiological means if in newborn, in infant, in female, during exercise, during excitement, emotions and nervousness, normally the respiratory rate gets increased. So in this condition, if the respiratory rates are more, no need to worry, it is physiological. But some conditions which are causing hypoxia, okay, that time respiratory rate increases. Here the example is pneumonia, okay. And nowadays we get to see many tachypneic patient because of COVID-19 infection, okay. So that is actually pathological. Then what are the causes of bradypnea? So bradypnea normally do not occur. It only occurs in pathological condition when there is CNS depression, okay, or narcotic poisoning. Now, on inspection, we completed position of trachea, shape of chest, respiratory rate, movement of chest. Okay, now we'll talk about apex beat. So, apex beat is, on inspection, you have to just observe. On palpation, we will actually try to feel for apex beat. Okay, so on inspection, sometimes in some patient, the apex beat is not visible. It doesn't mean that it is not present. Okay, so maybe when the patient is obese, it is not easily visible, but in thin and lean patient it is easily visible. Okay, it is situated in left fifth intercostal space, half an inch medial to the midclavicular line. Then color of skin, prominent veins over chest, and any previous injury or suture marks are there on chest, you have to observe. So veins, how it is dilated, prominent vein, I have put a picture, see here. You can see here. Okay, so these are the points you have to see, these 8 points. Okay, here the inspection is done. Now palpation. Under this we will see temperature and tenderness, position of trachea, apex beat, chest movements, chest measurements, tactile vocal parameters. Okay, palpation. So temperature and tenderness. So when we will check for temperature and tenderness, why we have to check for temperature and tenderness? So whenever there is local rise of temperature in case of inflammation, and in tenderness in case of malignancy, when malignancy is involving the ribs, like involving bones. Okay, so that time on palpation of the chest, the patient will feel pain, and that shows that tenderness is present. So I have shown you in the video. Let's see.
Temperature and tenderness. First we will check for temperature. So temperature we check by using dorsum of hand, that is posterior aspect of hand. Here we are checking whether there is any local rise of temperature is there or not. Now let's check for tenderness. First we will rub our both the palms. Then we will press over the chest slightly to see whether the patient is having pain. If at all the patient is having pain, that means tenderness is present.
Now position of trachea. As I said, trachea is normally situated centrally or slightly on right side. We will see in video how to palpate for it.
To palpate for position of trachea, we will use 3 fingers. One is index, then middle finger and ring finger. So this index finger and ring finger, this you have to place on sternoclavicular joint. And middle finger is the one which you will use to feel for tracheal rings. So let's see how we will do. So this is index and ring finger. So this is a sternoclavicular joint. So this I am keeping here index finger, and here I am keeping ring finger. Now with the help of this middle finger, I will try to feel for tracheal rings. Okay, so this is how we check for position of trachea. Now another method, that is you can use index finger and middle finger. Index finger you have to place between sternocleidomastoid muscle and trachea. So if it and this middle finger you have to place between the another sternocleidomastoid and trachea, and if it is easily insertable then the trachea is in centrally, but if it is not easily insertable in any side, either on left or right side, that means the trachea has been shifted to that particular side.
Now what are the causes of shifting of trachea? The causes of shifting of trachea on the same side or on opposite side. Okay, when the trachea has been shifted to the same side, that means there can be the lung fibrosis or collapse. And if it has been shifted to the opposite side, that means there is maybe pleural effusion, pneumothorax or lung tumor. Now how do you understand by shifting on the same side or opposite side? So for example, if the trachea of the patient is shifted to the left side, so when the trachea has been shifted to the left side, we have to think that either on the left side there is lung fibrosis or lung collapse. So because of that, the trachea is pulled to that particular side. Means left side lung fibrosis or collapse is there. So that will be pulling the trachea. Okay. So means the same side means the pathology is in the left side and trachea is shifted to the left side. Means same side of the pathology the trachea has been shifted. Means the trachea is pulled. But now for example, on right side there is pleural effusion, pneumothorax or tumor. So what happens that time, the trachea will be shifted to the left side because there is massive pleural effusion on right side or pneumothorax, and that because of the enlargement of the lung, the trachea will be shifted to the opposite side. Okay. So in the next slide, we will see apex bit. So as I said, it is situated in the left fifth intercostal space, half an inch medial to the midclavicular line. I'll show you in the video how to check for apex bit. But again, apex bit also same like trachea, when there is shifting of mediastinum, also there is change in position of apex bit. Okay.
Now let's palpate for apex bit. Now first we have to use our palm. Okay. So usually apex bit is situated normally in left fifth intercostal space, half an inch medial to the midclavicular line. This is midclavicular line. So half an inch medial to the midclavicular line in left fifth intercostal space. So first you have to use your palm to feel for apex bit. Then you have to locate it by ulnar border. Then with the finger. Now we palpate for apex bit. If at all it has been shifted, either slightly on left side or right. So whenever there is mediastinum has been shifted, that time the location also gets shifted.
Now next, chest measurement. So under this, we will measure for the transverse diameter, AP diameter and full chest diameter. Transverse diameter is more normally as compared to AP diameter. Okay. So now how to check for it? We will see in video. Okay.
So chest measurement, we will measure transverse diameter, AP diameter and full chest diameter. So for the AP diameter, we have to place cardboards on front of the chest and back of the chest, right? And then we will measure a distance between these two. Okay. So this is 26. Okay. Now we will check for transverse diameter. So that is, we will keep between these two. Okay. And then we will check a distance between these two. That has come 33. So transverse diameter has come more than AP diameter. Okay. So it is 96. Now ask the person to deep inspiration. Which was the Now it is 99.
Okay. Let's see the video.
Now let's see for chest movements. So we will check for anteriorly, then posterior and apices. So let's see for anterior. How I have to keep the thumb and fingers, that is, the fingers should be parallel to the ribs and thumb should be centrally. Now see, this is, now I will ask the subject to inspire, then expire, inspire, then expire. Now little bit down we will do, inspire, expire, inspire, expire, inspire, expire, inspire, expire. This is anterior chest movement. On posterior side. So again, finger should be parallel to the ribs, thumb should be in the central. Now ask the subject to inspire, then expire, inspire, expire. Now on apices, ask the subject to inspire, expire, inspire, expire.
Then what are the asymmetrical chest movement? See, by doing chest movement we get to know that whether the movement of the chest is equally on both the side or not, right? So when it is not moving equally on both the side, means one side of the chest movement is less as compared to other side, that means your one side of the thumb will move less as compared to the opposite side of thumb, right? So that time we get to know that the chest movement is not symmetrical on both the side, rather it is asymmetrical. So causes could be, maybe the side of the thumb which is moving less, that side maybe the pleural effusion is there, pneumothorax is there, emphysema might be there, fibrosis is there, or lung has collapsed. Okay, so these are the causes. Now tactile vocal frailties.
So in tactile vocal frameters, so what is tactile vocal frameters? That is a vibration which has been transmitted to the chest wall from the vocal cord, and that has been felt by the ulnar border of hand. Okay. So how do we check? We have to place the ulnar border on the areas of the chest. Okay. So let's see. During this, we have to ask a person to speak 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3 continuously. Okay. 1, 2, 3.
1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3.
Then on axillary part,
1 2 3.
Then here,
1 2 3.
Then again here,
1 2 3. 1 2 3. 1 2 3. 1 2 3. 1 2 3. 1 2 3.
Okay. So I am feeling equally on both the side of chest. Okay. Vibrations are felt equally on both the side of chest. Now on posteriorly.
Let's continue. 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3 1 2 3.
So what are the causes where tactile vocal fremitus increases? It is in lobar pneumonia and tuberculosis. Whether it decreases in bronchial obstruction, pleural effusion, pneumothorax, collapse, thickened pleura, lung collapse and thickened pleura. Now percussion. So percussion is done for knowing the lung border, and also based on percussion note we get to know about differential diagnosis. Okay. Like if it is resonant, then it is normal. If it is hyper resonant, then it is a different condition. If it is dull, then it is a pleural effusion. In that way we come to a differential diagnosis. So where we will do on anterior chest, we will do on midclavicular line, then on lateral side on mid axillary line, and posteriorly on scapular line we will do percussion. Now let's see percussion. Percussion is already taught to you during histotaking and general examination class, that how to percussion. So let's see video once again how to do percussion.
Let's see percussion. So in percussion we are using fingers. One is plexometer and another one is plexar. So what is plexar? So that is the finger which we are using to give impact, and plexometer is a finger on which we are giving impact. Okay. So by doing the percussion we can get an idea about the borders of lung. So percussion we will do anteriorly in mid clavicular line, then in mid axillary line, and then on posteriorly mid scapular line we will do percussion. Okay. And then for the apex of the lung we will also do percussion. When we are doing percussion in normally in normal subject, the sound is resonant. But when the sound changes, when it becomes hyper resonant or it becomes dull, okay, so that time we have to think that some pathology has been involved. Okay, so let's see. This is how I have to keep a finger. Only the middle phalanx of my finger should touch to the chest. Okay. And I will give now impact with the plexar. Okay. So we are doing in mid clavicular line now. Okay. Let's start. And it should be done simultaneously on both the sides. I got dullness. Okay. So now I will do on mid axillary line on fourth intercostal space. Fourth, then here fifth, then sixth, then seventh. On eighth I am getting dullness. So done mid clavicular and mid axillary. Even in mid axillary we have to do actually simultaneously. Okay. Here third intercostal space, then you have to do here, then again fourth here, then here, fifth here, then again here, in that way. Okay. Now we will see posteriorly. Okay, mid scapular line, even posteriorly we will see. okay. On 11th intercostal space, we will get dullness. So, by doing this, we get to know the borders of lung. So, now for apex of lung, okay. For apex of lung, we have to ask a person to see on opposite side. For example, I am doing for the right side apex. So, I have to ask a person to see on left side. And then I have to percuss on supraclavicular fossa. This is a clavicle. Above that, there is supraclavicular fossa. Now, I have to percuss. So, it will be resonant. Once again, this is clavicle. Above that, supraclavicular. Okay, this is resonant. Now, when I am checking for the left side apex, I have to ask a person to see on right side. Okay, and then again I have to percuss. So, this is resonant.
Now, when we are doing percussion for the posterior aspect, so that time we have to ask a subject to keep his both the upper limb in crossed position over the shoulder, and then we have to do percussion on posterior side. In the next slide, importance of notes. Okay, so now resonant is normally in normal lung. So when this patient is not having anything, right, when the lungs are normal, we will get to see resonant sound. Now when the resonance has been increased, means it has become hyper resonant, that means there can be pneumothorax, COPD, or maybe the cavity, large cavity, it can be a tuberculosis. Then dull note is seen in case of consolidation, which is seen in pneumonia. Then fibrosis, collapse, thickened pleura, we get to see dull note. And stony dullness is seen, or absence of sound, okay, we don't get any sound on percussion. So that is on pleural effusion. Okay, so these are the importance of notes. Normally it is resonant. Okay, and whenever there is air, A-I-R, R for resonance, and in solid, D, right, a solid, at the end it is D letter, so D for dullness. This is how also you can remember. Now let's see auscultation. So auscultation, we have to do, we have to check for breath sound, and then we have to check for vocal resonance. Okay, so breath sounds are vesicular breath sounds, bronchial breath sounds, and bronchovesicular breath sounds. So we will see in detail about this. And abnormal sounds, these are seen in pathological condition, not in normal subject. So those are ronchi, wheeze, stridor, crackles. Okay, now which are the areas where we will auscultate, okay, for the breath sounds? So those are supraclavicular, infraclavicular, mammary, inframammary, axillary, infraaxillary, suprascapular, interscapular, and infrascapular. I have shown all these areas in the next pictures. Let's see. So this is mammary area, doctor is auscultating. This is suprascapular area, okay. Then this is interscapular area. Then here doctor is auscultating on trachea. So for the bronchial breath sounds, we have to auscultate on trachea. And for vesicular breath sounds, we have to auscultate on periphery of lung. So bronchial breath sounds on trachea and vesicular breath sounds on periphery of lung. And this is on infrascapular area. Here actually triangle of auscultation is present, where we get to hear best breath sound. Okay, so triangle of auscultation is this, okay, which is medially bound by trapezius, then inferiorly by latissimus dorsi muscle, and then laterally by the scapula. Okay, so this is triangle of auscultation. So here you can see in the below, matlab lower part of scapula, we have a triangle of auscultation. So here the doctor is auscultating on triangle of auscultation, and there on posterior side of chest, best breath sounds we can hear nicely. Okay, let's see in the next slide. Vesicular breath sounds. So these are the breath sounds gets originated in the large airways, and it is heard all over the lung tissue except over the trachea. So vesicular breath sounds should be heard on periphery of lung. Presence of vesicular and bronchial breath sounds in normal subject is normal, right? But the location of these sounds are important. That is, vesicular breath sounds are heard on periphery, okay? But the bronchial breath sounds are heard on trachea. So this is vesicular breath sounds which is heard on periphery, okay, all over the lung tissue. The sound is low pitched rustling sound. Here inspiration, a sound on inspiration is longer and louder than on expiration, and there is no gap between that, you can see here. So this is inspiration and this is expiration. So inspiration is longer than expiration, okay, and there is no gap between inspiratory and expiratory sound. After this auscultation, in the last slide I have put a video where you can hear, easily hear the vesicular, bronchial and other abnormal sounds. We will see in the next slides, coming slides. So this is about vesicular breath sounds. Okay, next is bronchial breath sounds. These are originated by the movements of air in trachea and large bronchi. It is heard over the, best heard over the trachea, adjoining manubrium and upper sternum. It is high pitch blowing sounds, and expiration is more, means it is longer and louder than inspiration. Expiration is longer and louder than inspiration and with the gap. So you can see here, this is inspiration and this is expiration. Okay, and there is a gap. So in vesicular, inspiration was longer, whereas in bronchial, the expiration is longer. And in vesicular, there is no gap between inspiration, expiration sound. Here in bronchial, there is a gap. And bronchial is best heard over the trachea, whereas vesicular over the periphery. Bronchovesicular breath sounds. Here inspiration and expiration are equal and no pause. Found in early cases of consolidation and partial collapse of lung. Now let's see how to check for breath sounds. Okay. Checking on trachea for bronchial breath sound. Then on periphery for vesicular breath sounds. Ask a person to inspire and expire so that more clearly we can hear. Checking for a triangle of auscultation. Now, this is a video where we will see all breath sounds. Okay. Thank you. Now, vocal resonance. This is also second thing which we do on auscultation. So what is vocal resonance? It is nothing but it is auscultatory counterpart of vocal fremitus, and it indicates the conductivity of lung. Now, what is the difference between tactile vocal fremitus and vocal resonance? So tactile vocal fremitus is palpatory finding, whereas vocal resonance is auscultatory finding, right? So in tactile vocal fremitus, we are using ulnar border of palm. Here we are using stethoscope, okay, to hear for vibration, okay?
One, two, three. 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 One, two, three.
Now, when it is increased in pneumonia, in tuberculosis, and it is decreased in case of pleural effusion, pneumothorax, and collapse. Okay? And thickened pleura, emphysema. Next, few terms are there. What is eupnea? It is normal, quiet breathing. Okay, so where respiratory rate will be 12 to 18 per minute. What is apnea? So that is, it is complete absence or cessation of breathing. What is dyspnea? It is difficulty in breathing. Hyperpnea is increased rate as well as depth of respiration. Okay, tachypnea is increased rate of respiration, which is more than 25. Okay. And hyperpnea is hypercapnia, that is increased carbon dioxide level in the blood. So these are the few terms, okay? So we should know what does the mean, okay? Next, this is a table I have just put, that few clinical condition which routinely comes in hospital, okay? That pneumonia, COPD, pleural effusion, these are the cases routinely we get to see in medicine OPD and medicine wards. Okay, so what happens in this condition? You might get a question that why are we actually doing respiratory system examination? So basically, to get a differential diagnosis and okay, so we have to do the respiratory system examination. See, when a patient is having pneumonia, so in that patient, the chest movement will decrease, okay? Or on percussion of chest, we will get dull note. Tactile vocal fremitus would have been increased. And auscultation, on auscultation, actually, as I said, on periphery of lung, we will get a vesicular breath sound. But here you get bronchial breath sound, okay? And in vocal resonance is increased in pneumonia. In COPD, the chest movement decreases, percussion will be hyperresonance, tactile vocal fremitus will decrease, auscultation we get crackles, and vocal resonance will decrease. Pleural effusion, again chest movement will decrease, percussion stony dull note, tactile vocal fremitus will decrease, auscultation diminished breath sound you get to hear, and a vocal resonance will decrease. Thank you.